Welcome to another episode of The Cure, a video series dedicated to talk about the concrete industry and happenings. I'm Jonathan Kozlowski, editor of Concrete Contractor. This episode features an interview with Professor Mo Asani, the president and owner of Formatube LLC and Centennial Emeritus Professor of Civil Engineering of the University of Arizona. He's a well-known figure in the concrete world and has developed a number of products aimed at the aiding of infrastructure repair. Recently, he's come out with yet another innovation aimed at projects like bridge piling called Formatube. Your bio says you have more than 20 patented systems for infrastructure and construction. Let's start with those. Can you tell me about them?
My career, when I started as a professor of civil engineering at the University of Arizona in 1982, and as I tell people, my story is really simple. I went only to one university, University of Michigan. I got my bachelor's, master's, PhD all from one place, from about 73 to 82. Then I came to University of Arizona in 82 to teach here. And I was here for 28 years until 2010 that I left the university. But while I was at the university in about 1987 or so, we started this new idea, which at the time was really crazy, of retrofitting the decaying infrastructure, strengthening them, but instead of using steel, which was the culprit and was the cause of corrosion, instead of that, we decided to use carbon composite materials, which are very strong, but they do not corrode.
Okay.
And at that time, back in 1987, 88, this was a really crazy idea. Now, of course, it's become very popular, but I tell people it took me 30 years to become an overnight success. But everything really that I do, it all started, you know, the main theme is strengthening of the infrastructure, but not using conventional methods and material, using different like composite materials.
Okay.
And so we started, you know, strengthening of beams and columns and making buildings blast resistant. And then, in fact, the name of the company, QuakeWrap, which I, you know, founded it in 1994, the name QuakeWrap came about because there were a couple of earthquakes in Loma Prieta earthquake in 89 and the 1994 Northridge earthquake, where a bunch of these buildings in California were collapsing. And then one of the main causes of collapse was that in the columns, they did have enough longitudinal bars, but they didn't have enough ties. So we came up with this idea that if you took these strong carbon fabrics, like a bandage, and you wrapped it around a column,
okay,
you could make it earthquake resistant. Thus the name Quake Wrap, it is, that's the namesake for our company, was to make the buildings earthquake resistant.
Is there a certain magnitude that those?
Yeah, I mean, you could really make them then to take, you know, pretty high, like magnitude eight or higher, even by depending on how many times you wrap them, you could make them extremely strong.
How popular is that system? Is like regular buildings using that?
Yeah, it's become really popular. Basically, you know, there's another alternative with conventional method is that they would put two half pieces of a pipe around the column and weld it together to create this steel shell on the outside of the column. And
sure,
then they would pour grout to fill the annular space and make the column and the steel pipe, if you will, work together. That's one way. But it is, as you can imagine, you know, like it would require heavy lifting equipment, potentially traffic lane closures when you're doing these on bridges. In our case, it's very simple and lightweight. And so there are agencies like California Department of Transportation. They have used this, and other states, they have used this a lot, you know, for retrofitting of bridges. In fact, in California, in many cases, they have both the composite or FRP option and the steel option on the same drawing, and they leave it up to the contractors, whichever is economical for that project.
Sure. How do you go from creating QuakeWrap to forms?
It all really started from that same concept of strengthening piles. So we were repairing those piles, and we were, you know, in that original system, if you have a damaged column, you have to clean the column, get rid of the corroded rebar, maybe clean it up, put some, patch it up, and then wrap the fabric around. So then about 15 years ago, one of the products that I came up that we got several patents on was that system that I was telling you, the original, it's called wet layup, where you wet the fabric and wrap it like a bandage around it. That doesn't lend itself really well to do it underwater. So for repair of ports and piers and so on, that wasn't a good solution. So I came up with this other product called Pile Medic. We can take these fabrics of carbon or glass, and in our facility, in our manufacturing plant, we add heat and resin to it. And instead of, in fact, I'll see if I have a piece of it to show you. We can take that fabric, which is very flimsy, but we could convert it, you know, make a laminate, very thin laminate. So this can be, you know, now you see you can mold it, you know, to any shape you want. Because these are very thin, we could actually take, like, imagine if I have a 4-foot roll of, you know, several hundred feet long now. I could take these rolls and wrap them around a pile like two times, and with a little bit of epoxy put in between, I make this shell stick to itself. I create a tube around a column.
Okay.
Loosely fitting. And then I can send that tube down into the water and, you know, attach another 4 foot, 4 foot, 4 foot to it and push it down, go as deep as we want. And then in the next stage, we would fill the annular space between this tube and the column with a grout. Okay. So this is how we came up with this system for repair of piles. And this has been tested by many agencies. It's the only product that the Army Corps of Engineers has tested and approved it for the military's use worldwide. So we sell these to the military. In fact, there was a story they had in the US Navy had published a story a couple of months ago that they were, some of the material we had shipped for them, they were repairing some piles in Ukraine, and they put a story with their own pictures of how they were fixing this port in Ukraine, the US Navy was doing.
Well, that's cool.
So yeah, so there's a link to that. I can send it to you. It was just an unclassified story that they had put up, but pictures of our products being wrapped, you know, would put on those piles.
Are you guys making like a void, a dry void, so contractors can get in and do repair, or are you just making that shell and then making the pile thick again?
Yeah, making it thick again. You know, they would pump the grout in that annular space. The nice thing about this is that the entire system, everything can be cured underwater. So we don't need to, you know, we don't need any coffer dams or anything like that. And that really saves. And what the military, for example, liked, especially about this product was, is that, you know, when they buy these kits, you know, like a kit kind of like contains several hundred feet of rolls of these laminates, and with a bunch of epoxy and gloves and, you know, spacers and all the tools that they need. So when they open it up, whether you have a small or square or rectangle or whatever shape or size of pile you have that is damaged, you just cut the right length of this laminate from the roll and wrap it twice around it and create your own tube. So there's really no pre-ordering for the military. This is wonderful because all of the other products on the market, you have to order them a shell made to the size, and it takes them 6 weeks to order to get it to you.
Sure.
And so that's one of the benefits of it. So this is what this product, and which is called Pile Medic, and I developed this about, like I said, 12 years or so ago. This is becoming very popular, and it is the Cadillac of the industry. It's not cheap. But it is the best product on the market.
And anything good isn't cheap.
Yeah. And so my salespeople were telling me that, you know, we have some projects where we are competing with other, you know, products where the contractors or the engineers have just specified a kind of like a, you know, a shell, just any kind of shell to pour some concrete in it. And they, you know, just like a stay in place form. We couldn't, obviously, price wise, we couldn't compete.
Sure. So, is the Pile Medic one time use, or
yes,
are you removing that?
It's a one time use. It stays in place, and it provides so much additional strength far beyond anything on, because it does the same work of, remember when I was saying that we took that fabric and wrap it around and make it the column strength? Well, this is the same fabric. So now if you encase a column in this thing, it becomes extremely strong. And it has been tested by like Texas DOT, Caltrans, Nebraska Department of Roads, different agencies, Army Corps of Engineers. So move forward, you know, now coming back closer to like about a couple of years ago, I started thinking that I wanted to come up with something a lot less costly and yet have some of the unique features of this PileMedic that like you don't need to order ahead of time to the size that you need and so on. So then I came up with this, you know, this Forma tube. And what these are, these panels, you know, they have on one side of them, they're very smooth and flat. And on the other side, they have these protruding T profiles. And along the edges, they have a male and female connector. So you can take these pieces and just like the edges of them, they snap together and you can make, you can put multiples of these together and make any diameter that you want. Okay, so sure. Every panel end to end is 6.28 inches or 2 times pi. So with that dimension, every panel that you add, it adds exactly 2 inches to the diameter of the tube that you make. So 6 of these makes a 12, 7 of them makes 14 inches and so on.
Okay.
And you could put these around a, like for repair of a pile in water, if you do it this way. And when you make a tube like that and you pour the grout, then the grout would grab these T profiles and it would permanently, you know, stay in place. This is, again, that's a unique feature that there is no other product on the market that all of the other products have a flat surface on the inside. This is the only one that has these protruding T's.
And does that add like a reinforcement type of thing? Do you need banding on the outside?
Not so much of it. This really does not do anything, like, to be fair, you know, it's not as a reinforcement, but it is only as a stay-in-place formwork.
Okay.
And so once, you know, it helps you, you know, pour the concrete, and then because it has this impervious surface, it prevents moisture and oxygen to get into the underlying pile. And, you know, and you need oxygen and moisture to, as a fuel to the corrosion process. So once you stop that ingress of oxygen, then the corrosion process comes almost to a near halt state. Add a lot of service life by wrapping, you know, a column, like let's say, but if you have a bridge column that gets, you know, in your area, for example, you have a lot of salt spray on the roads. You look at like in the Midwest, a lot of these bridges, the damaged area is not necessarily the full height of them. It's usually the bottom 2 or 3 feet because of the road traffic and the salt spray splashing on that. So it would be very easy to put, you know, 2 or 3 foot high shell like this around those and then fill it, you know, pour it with some concrete. And then, you know, all of that salt and chemical spray would just get on this plastic sheet and gets washed away. So,
okay. Well, and then you would just leave that there. You don't have to try to remove that and clean.
No, in that application, you're right. When you pour the concrete against that this surface, it grips it and stays it. But if you go the other way, you know, with the smooth side, then this is a reusable concrete form, like a sauna tube, but a reusable one that allows you to make a diameter, any diameter you want. And after the concrete sets, the next day you remove these and make a different diameter or same diameter for me.
Yeah, I was going to ask you about if you could flip and use the other side, because I understand there's the cardboard tube that gets placed in and then you just remove that.
The cardboard tube, once you use it, the only way to remove it is to tear it apart and send it to a landfill. With this thing, you can use it as a reusable mold.
What's the lifespan? How long is it going to last on the bridge?
But this has already included in the material. There's a UV-resistant material in the matrix of this. So I would say easily in the range of, you know, 25 years or so without any, you know, maintenance.
That's pretty good. Well, yeah. Have you done the, like, testing and stuff like that to it?
We haven't really done it particularly with this, but I know that from the same manufacturer, when they have those UV additives on it, they use these on some of the other non-structural elements on like railings, on porches and so on in the building industry where they're exposed to sunlight. So they have, you know, very good data from that they know these last a long time.
You mentioned bridge repair. Where else would contractors kind of utilize this, since you're only going 6 inches? per little block, but then you can stagger them and build as high as you need.
Yes, of course, the length of these, by the way, the length of these, even though you could stagger them and make them as high as you want to go, but the panels, the standard strips that we sell, they are, you know, 6.28 inches wide. They come in 8 foot long or 4 foot long pieces.
Oh.
So we can make them. And if somebody wants them, you know, we did a job actually in Houston where we're repairing some piles that were 14 feet tall. So we made custom made those 14 feet tall if somebody did. But the beauty of it really is that even from short pieces, you can create your own a jacket of any height that you want. You don't need to order a 14 foot length. You can buy like a 6 foot and an 8 foot, one after another creates a 14 foot, you know, or.
Sure. Or should the pile be like an oval shape?
Yes.
You can just create enough pieces to get
exactly
around that.
Because these are really flexible. When you make a sheet, you know, that is wide enough by putting several of these 6.28 inches together, then you can wrap that around an oval shape pile, for example. It doesn't need to be circular.
You could okay. How short can you go?
Oh, short, you can go, I mean, you could go to 2-3 inches, but if somebody really needs it. But imagine even if you had like a 1 foot long pieces and just by tiling them, you could easily make something 6, 7, 8 foot tall.
Wow.
And the pieces are so small that they could fit in your briefcase. And then you come out and you start creating this tower. You know, that's really the, you know, cool thing about it.
Those ridges, they're not all interlocking. There's a specific one that interlocks
yes.
with a specific one. You can't just cut and then just make sure that little 3-inch space that fits.
Yes, you're absolutely right. You know, so you only connect these at the edge, you know, that they get snapped together.
Sure.
And once the edge is connected, then on the other side, these only intended to just remain. So every panel has two of these that don't interlock with anything, like the, you know, this one and then this one. They're only there to grab the concrete or grout, but they don't interlock with, you know, the edges or anything else.
Removing the 8 foot tall piece, should they use the clean side on the inside? What's the removal part of
it? So for that, for example, they may want to go, if they want to go that route, a contractor may want to go, let's say if you want to really cast an 8 foot tall column, and let's say you do have like 8 foot long panels, you could put a lot of them as 8 foot long pieces, but one of the panels, you could make it with a series of shorter ones.
Okay.
So once the concrete is cured, you need to pull one of those strips up vertically. And once you start pulling that up, then the other ones just open up like hugging something and unhugging it. You know, it opens up. But that first one, you want to just pull it up. And that allows you to then the rest of them would fall apart.
Okay. So it's really just like tension, keeping it all together.
Yes.
You don't need to band anything around.
Initially, when you pour the concrete, yes. Initially, when you pour the concrete with the model, you know, with the units that we are making right now, we recommend that if you're casting concrete, you put on the outside of this shell, put a few ratchet straps every couple of feet to help it with taking the force of that wet concrete.
Sure.
But then the ratchet strap, you remove it and, you know, save it and use it over and over again. There is a balance that if you made the connection so strong and tight, it wouldn't go together so easily. So you have to pay a price for it. Do you really want it? You know, and I figure that it is a lot easier to use that external ratchet strap, you know, those are inexpensive. You just put a few of those and versus trying to make the connection really hard that it wouldn't go in so easily and be extremely strong.
Let's say you have your pile and it's circle. How do you get the forma tube perfectly centered?
Oh. Okay, let me show. Yeah. So as a part of our Cadillac system, we have developed this thing, but we can use it on forma tube. Actually, like that's one of the things that the U.S. military wanted, and we developed this thing for them. So we make these spacers that you see, okay? These spacers are included in a kit of that pile medic that we sell to the U.S. military, okay? And to, you know, to other customers too. But the same thing, they can be used. So let's say you put 4 or 5 of these through a zip tie and snap it around, you know, the pile like that. And then the longitudinal rebars would be snapped in place. So now, you know, as an engineer, you know exactly where the location of every bar is to calculate this. And then, you know, if you have like with pile medic, for example, if this is the jacket that we have, you know, then the jacket just like slips over it, you know, like so. And sure. You have it perfectly, you know, you could use the same system together with this one, you know, if needed, by the spacers separately. And so the spacers is just another product that just a couple of months ago we received the US patent on that. It's amazing that all these years, like nobody had really thought about coming up with a system that would ensure that you get your rebars placed in the right place and, you know, help you with this kind of underwater construction.
Sure. And making it at a price point where it's usable, but those are one-time use. You put it in there, it's gone.
They're gone, yes. Yeah, they're right. But, you know, Jonathan, you know, a lot of people really, they don't realize how some of these marine repair projects, they are so expensive, mainly because if you have to employ divers to do these repairs, a typical dive crew, which consists of four workers, for an eight-hour shift, that dive crew costs between $5,000 to $6,000.
Oh, wow.
And they cannot even work the full 8 hours because if the water is deep, they have, you know, safety rules require them to come out and be, you know, decompressed for so many minutes per hour and so on. So it's really expensive. And, you know, when you think of like spending some pennies on, you know, putting some of these things and making their work more efficient, you know, like this assembly of the jacket above the water line and sending it down, it just saves a lot of on dive time. So typical prices, just so that you know, like let's say if you're in Maryland or New York and you're repairing a timber pile in water, typically these jobs, they, depending on the amount of strengthening that you do, they end up costing materials and labor installation, they are in the range of $800 to $1,000 a foot.
Sure.
For repair of, and then every pile typically has, you know, anywhere from like 8 feet to maybe 10, 12 feet of repair done. So you're talking about per pile, it's like $10,000 to $12,000 almost, you know, depending on
wow.
the size. And the way these ports and piers are constructed, you have a large number of piles that are always very closely spaced. So it's not uncommon to go, unlike, you know, a bridge project that you go to, there may be like 10 or 15 columns on a bridge. But when you go under a port or a pier to fix it, there are thousands of these. And so it's not uncommon to have, you know, 200-300 piles in one corner of the structure that need to be fixed.
Sure. How can like a contractor, if they're interested in looking for more information on this or buying your product, where can they go? How do they purchase?
So the best way for Form a Tube is to go to formatube.com, and that's form-a-tube.com. So that's the website for that. For our other product, Pile Medic, is pilemedic.com. So if they go to any of those websites, they can find a lot of more information. We are also really rich in video content. So if okay. you go to any of our websites, there are a lot of videos that both in terms of education and training, as well as, you know, learning how the product is used. And then we also, through our construction company, we offer a couple of times a year contractor training and certification courses. So the contractors come to our classes and they learn how to install our products, including Pile Medic and, you know, Formatube and those things.
That's cool. So you've been a professor since, I think you said, the 80s.
Yes, from 1982 to December of 2009. But, you know, the last almost like 10, 11 years that I'm a professor emeritus now, so I don't regularly teach.
Okay, all right.
It was too much to do this, you know. And the business really, so as I said, you know, so this is like the 17th year of my business, or 27th year of it. And the first few years where I was both a professor and had that business, the growth of the company was really very, you know, small every year, year over year. But since I left the academic world and focused on the business fully, we've really taken off. We have about 60 employees in the company. And so, I mean, you know, in concrete, I mean, there's always been a lot of advances, you know, in the materials, durability of it, everything. But still, we do have a lot of aging infrastructure that were, you know, that was built, you know, 30, 40, 50 years and more ago. And definitely, you know, in terms of business opportunities, really, the cost of repair and maintenance of these structures of the existing infrastructure, that market size is far more than the size of new construction.
Definitely, especially with all that construction, I believe it was called the New Deal, getting us out of the depression, all of that construction has to be repaired constantly. Yeah.
And so, you know, it seems like actually with the new administration, they're already talking about really this time really going after this, doing some infrastructure work. You know, construction, not only it generates a lot of work for the actual laborers, but when you look at it, it really has so many, you know, its tentacles in so many different parts of the economy. You get, you know, trucks that the trucks, you know, manufacturer that they want to buy the trucks for those is equipment, you know, people in material supply from timbers to steel to, it could have a very big impact on revitalizing the economy and getting it going, you know, when we are in downtimes.
Definitely. Do you think there's going to be that uptick in infrastructure repair?
I hope so. I mean, you know, ultimately it is, I mean, we have to do that. And you can only put that off for so long. In fact, since I know you live in that part of the country, it reminds me 10, 11 years ago when that bridge in Minnesota collapsed. Yeah. I was actually that night, I was the first one that CNN called and Anderson Cooper and I, we were for about 11 minutes live on TV. I was trying to explain what had potentially gone wrong with that. But, you know, if we don't maintain our infrastructure like those bridges and underground pipes and so on, these are going to crumble and the cost effect of it and, you know, the impact on the economy and closure of the roads and traffic disruption, all of those are far more than if we planned ahead and established a maintenance program for these.
Well, thank you very much. I'm just about out of time. So thank you very much for your time joining me today.
Sure, thank you. It was very nice. I enjoyed the opportunity.